Our next speaker is the president of the Illawarra Beekeepers, hence my boss. She, very, very active president of this club. She helps out on training courses and she runs very successful school holiday program, bees and pollination for 8 to 12-year-olds. Penny's currently participating in the Certificate 3 beekeeping purely to expand her knowledge on bees. For the last 3 weeks, Penny has been presenting bees, insects and pollination to over 1,200 school-aged children with the Royal Agricultural Society. She loves to share her knowledge and is forever trying new bee-related activities. So I'd like to present Penny Downey, who is going to talk to us about sweet remedies and the healing herbal honey. Thank you, Penny.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming today. It's great to see quite a few people here. I bought myself a book this year and I started reading through it and I loved it. So this is the book. Give me a bucket of honey or a couple of kilos of wax and I'm a happy person. I will sit and fiddle and play and make, do, whatever I can with those products. I enjoy doing that sort of thing. So I like, when I bought this book, it's called Sweet Remedies and Healing Herbal Honeys. It's an American book. It gave me a start of just to sort of fiddle around with some honey and see what I could do with it. So honey is a precious commodity to be valued and conserved. The role of honey as a medicine is the true value of honey, not as a simple sweetener, but as a medicinal food. So I sort of was reading the book and some of the recipes in here are quite complicated. There was a lot of ingredients that I had to look for and I found it very hard, but I kind of think that's just because it's an American book. And I thought, no, there's got to be some simpler sort of things. So I started fiddling around with a few infusions. So simple infusions, just adding herbs to honey. There's so many things in your garden you can just add to it. Thyme, sage, lavender, rose petals, even just orange rind. Peel off some orange rind and add it to your honey. And it just changes the flavour of the honey, but it just adds something to it. And a lot of herbs are really good for you, so there's a lot of reason to sort of, we don't get herbs in our diet all the time, but if you add them to honey, they taste great. So herbal infusions, they're just created by adding fresh herbs or spices to raw honey and just allowing them to steep. You don't need to add heat to it, but the book does say that if you put them in the sun, it helps to develop the flavours a bit. I probably cheated with some of mine and I really did heat them up probably a little bit too much, but that was just something that I learnt with practice and experimenting. Then I sort of went, okay, now I need to be a little bit slower at doing it and just leave them into a warm place. So some of them sort of taste good after a week or two and then some take a little bit longer. Just for the flavours to develop and the transfer of the honey and oils that are in the plants into the honey. So they say in the book that you should cut your fresh herbs, let them wilt for a little while in the sun or in a warm place, just before you add them to your honey. It sort of gets the oils starting to work, reduces a little bit of the moisture that's in your herbs as well, because you don't want to add too much moisture to your honey. So when you do that, you just let them sit in a jar in a nice warm spot, and every so often you taste it and just think, okay, well this is starting to taste really good, so I will take the herbs out. I have samples for everyone to taste this afternoon. If you're interested, you can, in the hall down in the apiary, I'll put them out on the table and you can come along and taste them. I have left the herbs in the honeys just so that everyone can see how much herb I put in the jars, but also so you can see what was in each jar, because I think it just looks attractive. And the only thing is, if you were doing it for yourself, strain the herbs out and then just use your honey. It's a little bit easier when you get a spoonful of honey with a few thyme leaves that have dried and sort of, I don't know, it just loses a little bit in the texture. But anyway, experiment for yourself. So one of my favourite ones that I've done so far has been the sage with honey. So sage is good for the digestive system. It calms indigestion. It allows the body to break down fats. It's an antiseptic, and it is great for sore throats. It helps during menopause, and is excellent for lymphatic and the immune systems. And I was really surprised, because I'm not a sage fan. When I use sage in cooking, I always tend to use a little less than normal, but when I added it to the honey, I went, wow, this is really, really tasty. So if you don't taste any of the other honeys, give the sage one a go and give it a try at home, because it was really, really good. So the first picture on you up there is the sage honey. Then the next one is coffee-infused honey, and it was different. It's very, very strong, but I did put a lot of coffee in the honey. And the other mistake I made was I ground the coffee a little bit too fine. So do it a coarser grind, make sure you can strain it out, and perhaps don't use as much as what it says. By the way, I should have said at the beginning too, if anyone's interested in any of the recipes, you can give me an email and I'm happy to send them through to you. The third picture on the screen, probably one of my other favourites, is lemon cordial. And all you do is just cut a few lemons, stick them in a jar, top them with honey, and let it sit for a little while. And that has just had some soda water added to it as well. So it's just really, really tasty. So that's the recipe for the lemon honey cordial. The only other thing I did was I perhaps left this one out of the fridge too long, and it did start to ferment. But there's nothing wrong with it. It still tastes really good. It just does have a little bit of a stronger flavour and more of a fermented flavour. But it's still really great. When you mix it with a bit of soda water and ice, it tastes wonderful. And you can also pop a little bit of gin in it. It's really good too. Garnish it with some mint and some lime slices, and you've got yourself a real fancy summer cocktail. Fermented garlic. Has anyone tried fermented garlic? This is a great way to preserve your garlic that you grow in your garden. You don't want to use anything that's been bleached, so don't use the purchased really white garlic bulbs from Woolies and what have you. Make sure you get some proper organic garlic. Peel it. Oh, I think it took me like 2 hours to peel that garlic for that jar. So give yourself a bit of time. Peel the garlic, pop it into the jar, fill it up with honey. Always leave a little gap at the top, because the garlic ferments, which means it's going to fizz up a little bit, and you don't want honey all over your bench. So just leave a couple of inches at the top of the jar. Oh, a week, 10 days it'll take. It'll actually stop fizzing once it's ready. It does stop fizzing. Then you can add a little bit more honey to it and put it in the fridge. And I've had my jar in the fridge for nearly a year, so I'm sort of getting ready to make a new batch for next year. And it's great. You can use honey garlic in anything that you would just use normal garlic. Stir fries, casseroles, garlic bread, whatever you do. And then the honey juice, so that the fermented juice that it's in, you can put it in things like salads, dressings, or just a little couple of teaspoons in your stir fry, just to sweeten the stir fry up. it's really great. Or like, got a cold, garlic's really good, so just eat a cube of garlic out of the jar, straight from the jar. That's tasty. So this was one that I made, one of the first ones I made, because I was suffering from arthritis at the beginning of winter. And I thought, oh yeah, arthritis recipe, great, I'm gonna do this one. Bought an avocado, dried the pit, the big pip out of the middle, and which didn't take very long. I was actually quite surprised. I sliced it up into small pieces, put it in a warm spot, and it actually dried within a couple of days. It does go a bit of a pinky sort of colour, which is not too bad. It looks all right. Then I put it into a coffee grinder to grind it up, mixed it with the honey, and went, yeah, this is wonderful. One tablespoon of one avocado pit to 6 tablespoons of honey. It sort of made a little jar full. And you're supposed to eat a teaspoon 3 times a day. Let me tell you, it is the most disgusting thing you've ever tasted. So I suffered for like 3 days eating it, and then I went, nah, I just can't do this anymore. It's really bad. So I think I brought the rest of my jar with me. If you really feel like tasting it, by all means, go for it and just eat the rest that's there. Sorry? I don't think so. I think the cortisone injection probably worked better that I actually had 3 days after I started eating the crap. So yeah, I don't recommend this one. And also in the book, it does say that you shouldn't do it for more than 3 months. There is a chemical in the pit that's not good for your stomach anyway. So I should have realized that was a bit of a warning and just go, nah, forget it. Anyway, it was interesting and I enjoyed experimenting. Chocolate honey. This is a great one. This is a new one that I've only sort of invented or discovered this week. I have tried chocolate honey before, but kind of went, oh, I don't know, it's sort of whatever. But when you make it yourself, it's so much more fun. So chocolate powder, I did 2 different types. So I did one with chocolate powder, which was organic chocolate powder. I didn't go the Dutch cocoa, I just went the organic. And I added it to the honey. So I only added a couple of teaspoons to the jar, thinking that, yeah, sure, I've got a jar of honey, take the lid off, add the teaspoons of cocoa powder in there, and went to try and stir it. You can't do that, it just goes everywhere. So make sure you put your honey into a warm bowl and then try and stir it, then put it back in the jar. That's just a quick tip. The cocoa, I was talking to a girl this week who's a chemist for a chocolate company, and she said to add a little bit of butter to the mixture and it makes it a bit smoother. But I was a bit concerned about the shelf life because I thought, oh, well, if you don't eat the whole jar straight away. But she sort of said to me, oh, well, no, the honey, the amount of butter you would be putting in wouldn't be that much and it would actually still be quite shelf stable. But it really did change the flavour of it and the texture of it. Just in a 250-gram jar, all I put was 10 grams of butter and it really did change it and it was quite good. So the other one I used was the curvature chocolate, which I went down to Nina's Chocolates at Guy Mier and paid $20 for 200 grams of chocolate and went, oh God, this is expensive. But I made up the honey and it tastes great. It was, I did the 1-to-3 ratio. So I think I put 1/2 cup of chocolate and 1.5 cups of honey, mixed it up. And it's really, really lovely. Like it's great. Would be fantastic as a dip for strawberries or on a cake. You could use it almost as an icing on a cake, but the expense is quite high. So that was just a couple of things that I did this week. I don't think I've got any more. No, so if you're interested in any of these, please just email me and I'm happy to pass you on an email with a printout of some other tips that I've got as well, and the recipes for all of these.